December, UN Assembly decided to designate 1st October as the International Day of Older Persons. And for this year, the theme is digital equity for all ages. I think the pandemic has finally made us realize that what is the importance of everybody having the digital literacy. Especially during the pandemics, we have realized that everything from grocery shopping to banking, from ordering our regular medicines and making payments have shifted to online. And that's why this year the international theme is related to digital equity for all ages. Now, for today's program, this is the first anniversary of Jyeshtha Care. So under the guidance of Dr. Srinivas Thakur, a year ago, the venture started. And for today's celebration, we are very, very thankful for our guests. We have Professor Nasreem Rustaprom, Mr. Vidya Shinoy, Dr. Rekha Bhatkande, Advocate Nirmala Savan Prabhavalkar, and Mr. Prakash Burgaonkar as our guests today. And I think now Dr. Srinivas will tell us about Jyeshtha Care and the journey of Jyeshtha Care. And then we will also go ahead and ask our guests to share.
Mudula, if you can share some about the guests, like what is their designation? Yes.
So, Doctor, so today our guest, Professor Nasreem Rustaprom, is a professor in Center of Lifelong Learning in TISS Mumbai campus. Mrs. Vidya Shinoy is Integrative Dementia Care Specialist, and she is also a Secretary General of ARDSI. Dr. Rekha Bhatkande has been ex-Dean of Sushruti Hospital, and she is currently a President of DILASA, which is a support group run by her. Advocate Nirmala Prabhavalkar has been ex-Mayor of Mumbai, and she is currently a Chief Functionary at RRTC. And Mr. Prakash Burgaonkar is the head of Maharashtra and Goa of Helpage India, which is the NGO who caters to underprivileged individuals with elderlies, right? Basically, elderlies with disadvantaged situation. Dr. Srinivas, now can you share about Jyeshtha Care and its journey with us?
Thank you, Mudula, for introducing all the guests. And I would like to, first of all, invite all the guest speakers who gave their valuable time and are present during this our celebration, our first anniversary celebration, as well as the celebration for International Day of Older Persons. So I'll be sharing small PowerPoint. So I'll be sharing what Jyeshtha Care has achieved in these last 1 year. So basically, Jyeshtha Care started during or just at the advent of before the COVID pandemic, when the first wave was there, because me being a geriatrician, I see exclusively elderly patients, and I saw the plight of many elderly that they were finding it difficult to access the healthcare. And most of them were isolated and required care at home. This is where I came up with this initiative. So it is basically Mumbai's first elderly specific home health care service, which is led by a specialist geriatrician. And we have started this initiative with the intention of redefining elder care, more specifically at the comfort of their homes. So we are always worried about our aging parents, especially people in my age group or my friends. I have seen that they're always concerned whether the elderly have taken their medicines on time. Are they regularly following up with their doctors? Are they able to live their life to the fullest? And so the various problems that are faced by the elderly during the pandemic and overall is there is poor supervision, lack of support to emergency services, limited access to quality healthcare. Especially in this pandemic, social isolation and loneliness has blown out of proportion. And the elderly care services or the trained caregiver services are there, but they are not at par. And many a times the interventions are inadequate or poorly timed. So we came up with the concept that there should be evidence-based standard of care. All our services, whatever is there, it is followed by a comprehensive assessment by our medical team. We have a proactive engagement with the patients and their family members while the services are going. When the care management is there, we have trained nursing coordinators who look after the clients and the staff. Thoroughly background staff is very important, and one important thing is make sure that the quality of life and independence is ensured as much as possible. With this, I would like to stop my screen sharing, and I would ask Vidula to start with some direct questions that we have for our guest speakers.
Right. So for our today's program, we thought that we will ask questions which will help us to help us and our participants to have an insight about importance of overall quality life for elderly people. And my first question is for Professor Nasreen, that how geriatric care needs a specialized approach. If you can help us to understand that.
Thank you, Mridula. My gratitude to the organization, Jeshtha Care, for inviting me today to be part of the panel. And I wish you all the very best on your first birthday and many, many more years of fruitful and meaningful work in the service of elderly in our country. I wish that for you and for our society. So with regard to the question that Mridula has asked, what is so special? Why do elderly need a branch called geriatric care? Now, nobody really asks this in terms of why do you need maternity care or why do you need pediatric care? So the very fact that we have to say why geriatric people require, you know, geriatric care separately, it means that there is so little awareness. The adult and the elder person very often is just considered an extension, you know, that you've just grown older and it's the same body and so on. But in fact, it is not so. So geriatric care is important because it allows patients to receive specialized care in keeping with the unique situation that they find themselves in. Now, this is very important to understand. And, you know, I'm a little careful because, you know, there are geriatricians here. There's Dr. Rekha Bhatkande, there's Dr. Thakur himself and so many others. And I'm responding to this particular question. But a simple example, for example, that I give my students is that fever never reaches very high. You know, elderly people never tend to get very high fever. So very often, even medical people are sort of, it's just 100, it's just 101, it's not much. But for an elder person, that is considered also, it will not go to 102 or 103 as it may go in adults. Fever remains low, but it still needs to be taken very seriously. So there are examples like this where we understand that geriatric patients, they require, you know, a separate set of understanding about how their body functions. A second thing is the importance that we have to give to their physical condition in terms of frailty, in terms of the chronic illnesses that they may have. And the third thing is that it is always a multidisciplinary approach. So geriatricians are the ones who will definitely keep this in mind and not just follow one unilateral way of treating patients. So I think these are some of the reasons why we require separate care for geriatrics. And most importantly, there are issues, say, with regard to adult immunization. Now, there are sometimes even medical people don't give sufficient importance to this particular factor. And I think it is definitely improving, and more awareness has come about. Unfortunately, COVID having, attracted attention towards the elderly, I don't think that's the best thing that could have happened. But whatever has happened, the silver lining in the cloud is that more attention is being paid to the health of the elderly.
Thank you, ma'am. And I think Vidya Shunoy, ma'am, and Prakash Borgaonkar, sir, have also joined us now. So welcome both of you. And we just started briefly with the introduction and the first set of questions, and Mridula can continue right now.
Yes, yes, definitely. So my second question was, as you know, Nasreen ma'am was explaining about why geriatric care, you know, overall elderly people need a specific approach when it comes to treating them. Vidya ma'am, can you also put shed some light on importance of older adults receiving a treatment and help from specially trained healthcare workers?
You'll have to repeat the last part of the question. I couldn't hear.
Right. Yeah. So importance of older adults receiving treatment and help from specially trained healthcare workers.
Okay. Thank you for asking me the question. I should be saying thank you, Jeshta Care, and a very happy birthday. And we're all there for you to become adults. And we grow younger by that contribution. Okay. So regarding special training, I think all of us need to be in school for normal education. Now, when it comes to adults, they have various mental and physical ailments, which tend to have a psychological effect on them. And to handle people with mood swings or, you know, diseases of old age is very difficult. And I think the main qualities that a carer needs to look after elderly is patience, empathy, compassion, something to let them know that they are needed. You see, as they age, I think everyone feels they are, you know, not contributing to the family finance or not doing any work. They are useless. Confidence level goes down. So I think, you know, for doing that, I think you need trained caregivers to handle them. And in the process, they tend to get back their self-confidence, or they know somebody is there to support them. And training is a must. And unfortunately, we have, you know, not a very big army. And I think we need to do training. And a lot of organizations like Nirmalatai's RRTC is doing a lot of, you know, programs for training. We do it for training for special dementia care. And Rekhata is also doing it. Nasreen is, of course, the backbone of the training program. And, you know, HelpAge is doing a lot. So I think all in our own way are doing something for the caregivers training, because it is a must. And we all feel that. We've seen the effects of, you know, untrained caregivers to trained. And it's much, much better.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Vidya ma'am, for guiding us on that. But since you are already a part of ARDSI, can you share what are the challenges you have experienced while dealing with dementia patients?
While dealing with?
Patients with dementia.
Okay. Actually, the problem is we don't have problems with persons living with dementia. It's their family.
Right.
When they are diagnosed, they refuse to accept that they are diagnosed with dementia.
Right.
So they'll go to a second and a third, and all of them say that. Then they think that we would go negate the doctor's advice when the reports show that they are affected with it. So I think the problem mainly starts with the family itself. Once they come, we try and convince them, better start now or it's too late. And we've had people come back to us after 2 years, and it's a bigger challenge now. Regarding persons themselves who have been affected, I think it's a matter of time, because they do not understand much. It's a non-verbal language that really helps us to deal with them. So even if the family has time for them, maybe the way they, you know, to look after them for 24 hours vis-a-vis 8 hours or, you know, or in a daycare, I think there is not much of a problem with the patients themselves, persons themselves, because they are under medication. So what I believe is that, you know, what we do should be the first line of intervention.
Right.
You know, medicines, they require because of physical health problems, and it is, but I think this has to be complementary. And then there's no problem. But by and large, I don't think we've had anybody who's really been difficult to handle. You know, and maybe we have a lot of patients and, you know, we think of the worst and it's not that bad.
Yes, surely, ma'am. But as Vidya, ma'am, you have specifically spoken about people who are suffering through dementia. Now, I would like to ask Nirmala, ma'am, that not related to any specific illness as such, but what are the challenges in your observation in general senior citizens do face?
There are a number of challenges which senior citizens or older adults find very challenging for the family also. And they are very commonly known for all of us, and they are all experts sitting here. And they are dealing with all sorts of challenges. But because this is a Zoom meeting and the question I need to answer, so there are 9 to 10 challenges, which I will just summarize in a minute. The most important challenge, which has already mentioned before by Professor Nasreen and even Vidya ma'am, that is a healthcare concern is a major concern. And healthcare concern, which also mental and physical. We all know that physically there's a degeneration by itself is a major concern. And as we say that aging is mandatory, whether you like it or you don't like it, but everybody, if very lucky to survive for a longer age, aging is a natural process. Nobody can avoid it, but it becomes a major challenge because if the health is in not good condition and morbidity is very high, like not curable diseases are also there, that becomes a very big challenge. Then as I said, that long diseases, diabetes is there, cancer, blood pressure, hypertension, so on and so on. And your organs also fail, you know. There's a basic organs are there, which taste, ear, eyes, etc., etc. And then mental diseases are worse than the physical diseases because absent-mindedness, Alzheimer's, dementia. And of course, mental health has so many other aspects, depression, typical mood swings and all that. These are the challenges which are very, 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 very important to be, you know, attended by the caregivers or by the family. The second one is, apart from morbidity, but the 65% senior citizens do not have their own income. The financial abuse is equally bad. So 65%, they do not have their own money. That means dependency increases on the other family members. Out of that, 39% of the female, I mean, I'm talking about a male and female. Female are the, if you see the gender perspective, the female senior citizens are worst affected than the male senior citizens because the ageism is there, but discrimination even at that age is also much more because of they are not earning. At least man is earning, some savings are there. He was working and all that. And respect patriarchal society always respects senior of all ages, but not that for the woman. So gender perspective also, you say that senior citizen female face more gender violence, domestic violence, mental abuse, physical abuse, and financial abuse. The third thing is that discrimination, as I said, between man and a woman. If you see the elderly man, he will be respected more. And you have seen that elderly man of 60, 65, nobody tells him, "Arey, you are old." But if you see that 40, 45 years old woman, also you discard. Yeah, acha uska bhi baal. I mean, this is a typical bad patriarchal approach to looking at a woman. Early age mein hum usko buddhi bata dete hain, lekin 60, 65 ka aadmi, "Arey, iska age bhi nahi dikha. Acha, ya aap to abhi bhi jawan ho." But nobody says that to a woman. We don't expect also. But this is a general, you know, myth and misconception and a bad mindset of the people that they take women, elderly women for granted, abuse ka kuch hai nahi, kaam ki nahi, like that. And disrespect, loss of dignity starts. She herself only has a low esteem in her own eyes. So that also, listen, I'm just concluding now. They cannot take, because they are not financially dependent, they cannot take their own decisions also. The decision-making power also goes with the age. That is common for man and woman same. Lonely feeling, of course, nobody likes to, you know, talk with the senior citizen. Thank God, at least some mobile and new digital technologies, they keep themselves a little bit busy on mobile and WhatsApp groups, and they pass their time. But that is not, Mumbai is not, Mumbai is not the Maharashtra. So Maharashtra lives beyond Mumbai. So we have to see that it's a rural area, the connectivity and loneliness still is a problem. Physical abuse, mental abuse, financial abuse, and shelter food, that is most important. That's why lots of people are in old age homes, because shelter itself is a major challenge, and poor and delinquent senior citizens have very, very bad problem in rural areas. But in rural areas, what I feel that in urban areas, the problem is still worse, because in one room, so many people have to stay, nobody has attention. But in rural areas, at least still that culture is there to take care of the senior citizens. So, and in a joint family, still it is there that take care of senior citizens, at least some respect is there. And social, taboo is there. If they don't like their senior citizens are sent in, neglected, and so these are all general challenges which senior citizens do face.
Truly, very, very expressively mentioned, ma'am. We all agree with that. Right. But since Nirmala ma'am have raised certain issues and concerns that definitely create a huge impact on the overall quality of life of senior citizens. So here I would like to ask Mr. Prakash Borugaonkar that what is the importance of having a good quality of life as senior citizens? Because many of our senior citizens in our culture tend to ignore their own health. And thinking that I don't need this, I don't need that anymore. Abhi to hamari to hamara time khatam ho gaya hai. Let kids have this time. And they ignore their own health. They ignore their own quality of life. Right? So what is the importance for them to have a good quality of life?
Okay. Thank you for inviting me. First of all, I take this opportunity to congratulate Dr. Thakur and his team for completing 1 year of GestCare. Chalo, ek saal ki baby ho gayi hai, bahut acha lag raha hai. That is so nice. Okay, now coming back to this, good quality life of elderly, correct? And you were just mentioning about your talking about this ignorance. Okay, you said we ignored and everything. So that ignorance is really harmful. Now, what is to be ignored and what not to be ignored? That is important. That's what I mean to say. Okay. Now, what am I? The things which we should ignore, that most of the elderly are not ignoring, and the things we should not ignore, which they are ignoring purposefully. Okay. Now, when we talk about these good habits or good quality of life and everything, and normally we talk about this graceful aging. You know, okay, aging, you cannot stop it. That is true. Everybody has to age. Okay. And secondly, now the longevity is increased, so everybody has to live for a very longer life. Now, it is we have to decide whether we have to live it happily or not. And just Mangesh Padgaonkarani matla hai ki hasad hasad jagaycha ki kanat kanat jagaycha. That is the question. And it is in our hand. Okay. Now, we have our lifestyle. I do understand. From the last so many years, we are following certain things and then we are continuing. And one fine day, then others realize that this is not a good thing. I'm just telling you. Nowadays, with all these elderly, they have common complaint that their children and the grandchildren always tell them not to eat this, not to do this, correct? So many things which they were used to up till now. So suddenly they feel very surprised and they don't understand ki whatever things I used to do up till now, I reached to this stage and now my children are telling me, don't do this, is not a good habit or this is not advisable. Okay. For example, take a case of carbohydrates. All the children that is don't have so much of carbohydrates, daddy, mama, don't do all these things, correct? And but we don't understand why there is a problem and we are reluctant, first of all. See, because we feel whatever I was doing, whatever I'm doing, it was good and it is good. But now everybody should understand that longevity is increased. We have to live for a longer life and we must have our healthy life. See, this is a need of an hour. Healthy life is very, very important. When I say the healthy life, it means you should physically and mentally should be fit. Now for physically fit, definitely you should have certain exercise, diet and so many other things are there. But mental fitness is very, very important. But are we really taking care of our mental health? Are we really doing certain exercise for our brain? Are we also doing certain activities or certain things which help us to keep ourselves happy? No. On the contrary, what we are doing it over the age, as the age increases, we are also increasing our expectations. Why? They should not be there at all. Now, expectations, having expectations from others is not advisable. This is my personal opinion. I do understand the society has changed. Everybody is changed. And with the changing time, we have to also change. So to have a good quality of life, definitely, we should start at the age increases. We have to start living certain things. That has always stayed. Kuch cheeze hame chhodna chahiye. Bahut zaruri hai. See, everything you cannot have it now. Now you should also have your diet control. You should also have control on your expectation. You should have also control on your exercises, so many things. I understand. Everybody feels that, yes, I am young. Agree. But you have certain limitations of your body. Your physical fitness definitely has certain limitations. Understand that. First of all, for living healthy life or good quality of a life should be, first accept it that you are a senior citizen. Number one. That is very important. Accept it. Nothing to harm. And that is why today's day, 1st October, is the day to celebrate the age. We should say proudly and happily, yes, I am a senior citizen. And that is why I am celebrating my age. So that is very important. Number two, after that acceptance, also accept your own family status and other activities, whatever you are doing, whatever the problem you have, accept it. Don't feel bad. I don't think that, okay, you are alone. Nobody's talking to you. You have been neglected or isolated. No issue. Nobody has done like this. It is you who is thinking. It is you who is behaving like that. That is why others are just neglecting you. So we have to see that. Whether am I right or wrong? That is very, very important. See, most important thing is with the seniors, you know, you have a lot of time and others do not have. So make the best use of your time. Understand. If you have time, it does not mean that others also have the time. Others may not have that much of time as much as you have. So first, plan your activities. You should also be busy physically and mentally. That will help you to be cheerful always. So you have to engage yourself. So many things you can do it. Now I'm telling you, today, 1st October, the United Nations has given the theme of IDOP is digital equity for all ages. How many of our senior citizens are really digitally literate? Are they ready to accept? Are they ready to learn this digital, you know, different equipments or the gadget? Today, see, the world has totally changed. Everybody is talking about the digitalization. But where are our senior citizens? They should also come forward. They should understand. I do understand they are the slow learner, but don't hesitate. You may do certain mistakes. You commit certain mistakes. No problem, but learn it. You also be in the flow of this digitalization. That is why United Nations has given the theme digital equity for all ages. So you take initiative. You start learning this thing. There are many organizations, many people, your own family members, they are ready to teach you. But it is you to take that initiative. And HelpAge India also, from last 2 years, we are doing this or conducting say digital literacy programs. We are teaching them. And many of the elderly or most of the elderly, we found they are very much interested.
Right.
And now they are enjoying their life with this. This is very, very important. So good quality of life, if you want to have it, you have to change with the time and understand what is the requirement.
Right. Thank you very much, Mr. Prakash, for raising very valid concerns. I think Midya ma'am also had mentioned concerns related to the mental health, which is often ignored, especially in elderly. And digital literacy, which has been the need of an hour. And that was my next question, which was going to go to Dr. Rekha, that what is the importance of digital literacy especially for elderly in today's time? And you being the role model for all the elderly, if you can shed the light on that, I think that will be great.
Okay. First of all, Dr. Srinivas and the entire Jyeshtha Care team, a happy anniversary. And it's on such a lovely day, and that is the, you know, Elders Day, the World Elders Day. When you bring up this whole topic of digital, connect digital literacy,
I mean, the first reason why all senior citizens actually started, showing an interest in the digital technology was really to stay connected. For the first time in our country, after a very long time, we had something like a lockdown. Okay? We only had that during the wartime. And we've never had a lockdown, otherwise. And the entire, what happened was there was a total disconnect in communication. And then I'll tell you, for the last 14 years, it's a senior citizen group. We've been having, for the last 14 years, without a break, we've been having monthly meetings, in-person meetings. And then in the lockdown, for the first 3 months of the lockdown, we were totally lost because we didn't have the meetings. And we weren't quick enough to turn to the digital platform. So the first thing I feel why we need to be digitally literate is for communication. I think it's so important to keep connected. The second is, of course, then, online banking and payments and online purchases, something which senior citizens really never did. It was so much easier to go to the nearest, brick and mortar, a little vani itha dukkan and get your stuff, But now one must learn how to get groceries online. Then, of course, where medicine is concerned, this entire digital health has come into play. We've never had consultations before. In fact, it was sort of banned by the Maharashtra Medical Council that you could not give a consultation pre-COVID, whereas it became the norm in COVID times, medical consultation. And because using apps to send reports, to send the imaging, and so the doctor could sit at home and actually be able to guide the patient. So I think digital literacy became extremely important. Now, what did people do? Like HelpAge India, who has been helping people, become digitally literate. Same way, just this morning, we were told by Mr. Aunde, the vice president of FESCOM, Maharashtra, that FESCOM has now started a digital academy. And they're also holding, online digital literacy program. I know we did this last month. We had approached Mr. Marathe, and he actually took all of us senior citizens just through one app, and that is WhatsApp, because everybody uses it, but not everybody knew how to use it and all its various, connotations. Then, of course, every one of us today, it's not about age. It is digital equity, right? So it's not about age. And we should know what are web browsers, what are search engines, how to send an email, what about making a PowerPoint presentation? All of us are online nowadays. There's so much that we senior citizens can learn and are learning and are being there's so many organizations that are there to teach us. We should learn. And the best people to teach you are your grandchildren. Believe me, they're good and they want to teach because they feel, that, oh, for once, instead of grandparents teaching us, we're teaching the grandparents. So I think digital literacy is something that we should embrace. We need it. And it will only help in the medical field. It's going to help tremendously. So that's my take on digital literacy.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rekha. This has emphasized the importance of why and probably have motivated our participants to learn from their grandchildren about how to use all the gadgets. Right now, I will request Dr. Srinivas to share the inputs about Jeshtha Care's journey since
yeah.
one
so,
year.
Because Professor Nasreen and Vidya ma'am have to leave before 6, so I just wanted them to see what we have done in this last 1 year along with the other panelists also. So right. I won't take long. So this was our first support group meeting. It was almost 11 months back, and you can see Professor Nasreen is highlighted over there because she is speaking in that support group meeting. It was our first psychological support group meeting, and even Rekha Bhatpande ma'am had joined this session. Then we created a session where we gave some tips to the elderly on rehab or physiotherapy exercises that could be done at their own level in their surrounding or at their home comfort level. We thought about something innovative where probably we wanted the seniors not just to give them some lectures or pravachan, but then we also wanted them to be proactively involved. So we came up with the idea that probably we should conduct an online dance session. So we are very skeptical whether this would succeed properly or not. I mean, but then we got good participation. I mean, people were just sitting around, but then as the session progressed, you can see from the photo, everyone was enjoying and they were dancing. So it was a fun event. Storytelling is another important aspect, basically, which we felt. So we conducted a few storytelling sessions professionally, and even the seniors were made to share their experiences or some particular stories that they had in their mind or they wanted to share with us. COVID vaccine, this was a very important topic because many were skeptical whether to go for it, not to go for it. And actually, this was the event which had the maximum participation. We had more than around almost 100 plus crowd who had come for this event. So we were fortunate enough to educate many of them about the importance of taking the vaccine. Digital literacy, something which we thought, I mean, this pandemic has brought out, many elderly have been able to use a lot of technology equipments, but then we thought this is something which we should talk about. We had a talk on diet and nutrition by our chief dietitian who was there. Dental care is very ignored, and my wife, who is a dentist, she took a good lecture on dental care and what could be the tips for adequate oral hygiene. Eye care is also very important, so we conducted a session on that. Bone health was one of the last sessions that we conducted with the orthopedician who gave us the knowledge about osteoarthritis, osteoporosis, and other bone conditions and how to take care of ourselves. The second wave was a big hit for everyone in the healthcare industry, and our team also did our bit. So in this way, we were able to provide our services. I mean, this was physical COVID care, basically, where they required some probably trained attendants or nurses or doctor visits. So more than 60 patients and their families we were able to provide. And our team was very courageous and determined to provide the services, taking huge risk for their own life. So we utilize, like I told, specific domain expertise and some technology to take care of the senior citizens, and we individualize the care plan. So we focus on health, engagement, support group, and teach some technology. Doctor consultation or doctor home, this is just some brief figures that I got out that I thought I should share with everybody. So this is just 1 year. We had almost 100 plus home doctor visits all over Mumbai. Doctor teleconsultations around 59-60, and COVID cases, like COVID teleconsultations, were around 56-57. Physiotherapy rehab, where we focus on home rehab, which is on geriatric, post-operative, orthopedic, and neurological. So almost 20 patients were under geriatric rehab, 20 under orthopedic, and 6 under neurological. Like last 15 days, I am not involved in this. Nursing care involves short-term as well as long-term. Short-term, like it is some procedure where they require some injection or catheter change or something. So we were providing 57 procedures that. And it involves even wound care management and vaccination. long-term nursing, like people who are elderly people who are really sick and require nurses to take care of them. So 12 hours we are able to, these are just 30 new services. So these continue for long duration, and 24 hours are 70. So if you see, we have provided more than 1 lakh hours of nursing care to our patients in the last 1 year. There's more than one, like actually I didn't count the exact number. So caregivers, trained caregivers, like here, I think Nirmala ma'am is also doing a good, RRTC is doing better, training the caregivers, which is a big need of the hour. So here we are providing post-operative care, companionship, general bedside care, and those who assist in their daily living. So 12 hours, we are provided 26 new services, and 24 hours, it was 91 new services, and many of them have continued for a longer duration. So here we have provided more than 150,000 hours of trained caregiver services to our patients. So with this, I would stop my screen sharing. And I would request Mudula to start. I think Vidya ma'am and Nasreen ma'am have to leave. So if she can focus her few questions on them right now.
Surely, Dr. Srinivas. But before I begin, I must congratulate you for the hours you have serviced, you know, provided services to people. Now, as Dr. Rekha had been speaking about digital literacy, learning new things, as digital learning is a new challenge for elderly people. Nasreen ma'am, what would you tell us about myths related to learning after retirement or learning in older age? And what are your suggestions to elderly when it comes to learning new things?
Thank you. This is really a very pertinent question, because you know the whole sort of area of digital literacy, and that's the theme also, you know, for the International Day, has put the focus on learning. I won't limit my remarks only to, you know, picking up digital literacy, but to the overall understanding that, you know, as the phrase goes, you can't teach a monkey, an old monkey, new tricks, you know, or to say that elderly are mostly rigid and stubborn, and actually cognitively they've slowed down, and all of these are actually myths. There is a biological understanding of what really cognitively happens. And I'm sure that many of the doctors present here and social scientists completely understand this. And Vidya, with her whole background in dementia, would also be very familiar with this particular aspect, which is that while short-term memory may decline, long-term memory remains the same. And in fact, over a period of time, elderly people, because of their experience, actually perfect their skills. And they may perform them at a slower rate than what they used to, but they will probably perform them in a much more excellent manner than they used to. Because their focus doesn't really deteriorate. So I think here people will ask questions about, you know, forgetfulness, that as you age, you do become more forgetful. I think that this is also something which is relative, actually. And we have this example of, you know, a gentleman who got a gentleman who was about 40 years of age, a middle-aged gentleman, got into a lift. And then he came running back, you know, to home, and had forgotten his umbrella and picked it up. And everybody at home commented that, oh, he's such a busy man. What can he do? You know, I mean, you know, you have to help him and stuff. And they told his wife, help him to remember, you know, taking his things. And the same thing happened with somebody who was in their late 60s. And they said, oh, this old man, you know, he's become forgetful, leaves his umbrella here. So when we use examples like this, we are really able to say how we stereotype or we have assumptions about, you know, age, old age. And the whole business, it was far back, 1996, actually, when I visited Israel, and they had classes for the elderly in what we are saying today, digital literacy or what Dr. Bhatkhande said, FESCOM has started a, you know, academy to learn digital skills. They were doing it in 1996. So really, it's because of our assumptions and stereotypes that we have not encouraged elderly to stay ahead on the learning curve. We have taken it for granted that their faculties would decline and that there would be a cognitive slowdown and that they will not be able to learn new things. And this is completely false. We have seen the number of people who in their late 50s and 60s have actually taken up new hobbies. They have taken up singing, they have taken up playing instruments. Definitely they have picked up, Skype. And so everything doesn't begin and end with COVID, you know. Even before COVID came, there were many elderly people who were keeping in touch with their children through something called Skype, which now would seem as if, you know, kaun se, you know, Baba Adam ke jamane ki aap baat kar rahe, kya, kya Skype kya, abhi to Zoom hi Zoom hai. So it's not like that. I think that we have to be a little more objective in understanding, and cognitive growth and decline is something that needs to be explained. I think awareness about this needs to be spread on a larger scale. This is what I would say.
Right, right. Thank you so much. Now, I will ask Vidya ma'am that what are the digital intervention ARDSI is taking when it comes to caring for people with dementia?
Yeah, I'm very pleased to announce that we've just launched an app. It's a music app. We did it with MTV India. They had come to us about 3 years ago, and I have a diehard positive attitude with a lot of patience. The meetings took place, and then, of course, you know, when it comes to money, the project was put on hold, and then we got a Santa Claus in the middle of July. And they called me back, and then we worked on the project, and MTV was very much into the thing. And we released it yesterday, And, you know, I'll send Dr. Srinivas the link where you can go. And it's an app that helps people remember. So it's called Memory Karaoke. Through the music, we have put, you know, blanks in the middle of a song, which makes remind, let them retain their own name, where they live, whether they've had food or not, and what they've had. Simple things, because we've had cases, you know, we also, all of us get on the WhatsApp messages, so-and-so is straight, so-and-so is lost, and there's a problem. So this is one thing we did, and we're very, very happy. And we hope that it's accepted by a lot of people. And I would suggest that you all, you know, also promote it. I will send it on the WhatsApp for each of y'all. And we've had an excellent response, excellent. And it's in, you know, it's, you can fill it up. It's Hinglish actually. And we will sort of develop that later. But I think that is the major one that we did. And it's the novel, the first kind that is customizable, and it's called Memory Karaoke. Coming back to COVID, I just want to make a statement before I run and hop into like a bunny in another session. COVID has actually bound us together. They brought us closer together. We have challenged ourselves. Like I keep telling the acronym, C is for compassion, O is for opportunity, V is for valuing our elders and for special persons who need us. I is the innovation. We've tried to innovate upon ourselves. We've tried to innovate for elders. We've tried to innovate for people with dementia or people who need palliative care. And the D is for a determination that we are going to make it. We're going to beat the challenge of COVID, and we're going to develop ourselves to be better human beings and to take care. I'm getting a next call, so I'm going to bid you goodbye and good luck. Okay. And all the best, and maybe meet next year again, before which we meet again for the celebration.
Thanks a lot, okay? Ma'am.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thanks for having me, and God bless each of you. Thank you.
And so that I don't disturb the session, it's 3 minutes from six. My class starts at six. So I'll also thank you and take my leave. Yeah. Thank you very much, Dr. Thakur and Mridula. Bye.
Thank you.
Thanks, ma'am.
Thank you. Bye. Yes. So moving on to our next guest. I would like to ask again, Advocate Nirmala ma'am, what is the importance of senior citizens having specially trained assistants? You know, in the context of if RRTC has any such programs, and if you have any specific experiences related to the program which were conducted by you, we would like to know about that.
Yes, sir, definitely, because gerontology or geriatrics is not much known to the common man also. And when I joined this 7-8 years back, I myself wasn't much aware of, you know, what is geriatrics, special needs of senior citizens, special emotional needs, special physical needs, special mental needs and all that. And therefore, I thought that to create an awareness in this sector. Incidentally, we got recognition from ministry, and ministry's mandate, they have number of policies, integrated program for older person, Vayoshri Yojana, Atal Vayoshri Yojana and all that. You see, government has got lots of policies, lots and lots of policies. But when it comes to, you know, reaching out to the common man, implementation is very important. And I'm very happy that studies and research, they are okay. Studies and research can be a part of a policy, but actually giving personal training, physical services, one requires offline training to certain extent, then to a large extent, and then online training to a large extent. So we thought of coming out with some sort of a pilot project with lead trainers like Amruta Patil Pimple, and Dr. Bhatkarne helped us a lot. There is a Neha Khare who helped, Prakash Burdavkar helped, recently Dr. I used to consult Dr. Srinivas also. So lots of people, you know, they came to help us and guided, and then we created a good curriculum. And our fifth batch of giving a training to geriatric caregivers is very important. I'll just answer in 1 minute, because you said, what is the importance of it? Importance is that ayahs are there. Already there are women who are, nurses are already giving help, but who can afford nurse? It is very difficult to afford a nurse. And nursing is for a bedridden patient who is really not capable of tending. In general, patients are there where they are capable of taking care, doing their own duties up to certain limit, but they require some kind of assistance. And that kind of a population requires a training. Then old age home also, you require a proper caregiver, trainer. Then daycare centers, hospitals and all that. So what we thought that if we can provide a good manpower, you know, nowadays there is a shortage of manpower everywhere. Everywhere, you go to talk to BMC, you talk to state government, you talk to all hospitals, and especially in COVID, we did not get a trained manpower, which 1 month training, 2 months training, depends what kind of assistance they are going to this one. So we thought that this is a very good idea. It will create a lot of employment to the unemployed youth, number one. Then elderly, we'll also get a trained caregiver, so they will know what basic things will be taught to them, what is mental health, physical health, emotional, nursing care, what are the laws for them, then what are the do's, what should not be done, what is the role of a caregiver. Caregiver should not take a step into the shoes of doctors. So that is very important to teach the caregiver's role, that you are only caregiver, you are not doctors. You are a caregiver, you are not a lawyer. So don't give any advice as far as the family disputes are concerned. Don't give advice to the patient. If leave it to the doctor, but see to it carefully, observation. So the training helps them to observe the patient and accordingly coordinate with the different kind of experts and do the duty of taking the emotional needs and then proper feeding, how the feeding is important, how to dress up, personal hygiene, personal assessment. These are the things caregivers, if they are trained properly, they can give, they can understand the senior citizens better, and they can understand with a better understanding, they can serve the senior citizens better, and senior citizens will also know that my trained caregiver knows everything. How to talk, speech therapy, prevent fall, so many things are there. Where different therapies are there. If we train them with basic introduction, they can, you know, take care of the patient in a much better manner.
Right. Thank you so much. Now, I will turn to Dr. Rekha. Ma'am, can you help us understand need?
Speak little loudly. I can't hear you.
This is how we can't hear you.
We can't hear you.
I think you can hear me now.
Yeah.
So thank you very much, Nirmala ma'am. Now I'll turn my questions to Dr. Rekha. Rekha ma'am, can you help us understand need and importance of having a specialty clinics and services for senior citizens? One, and how any private clinical setup or any corporate hospital aid in this, in the specialty clinics?
Okay, I think that's a nice question, Ritula, because we have now moved into an era where we are doing geriatrics, that is, the other side of the spectrum, the same importance that we actually are giving pediatrics. See, pediatrics have always been, you know, a very special branch of medicine.
Right.
And then it was, everything else was adult medicine. Right. And then we realized that when we were treating the elderly, especially the, 70 plus and 80 plus, you know, things like medicines themselves, the dosages, I mean, every doctor who treated them, whether it was a family physician, or whether it was a general physician, you know, they realized that they had to make adjustments in the dosages, just the way we did it for children. Okay. So, and then we are very lucky now that we have a whole new branch of physicians, and that is the geriatricians. I think I'm so happy, and, you know, they're such lovely young people like Srinivas and his colleagues, who are doing a wonderful job with addressing the special needs of senior citizens. And that is why that brings us to specialty clinics, because there's absolutely no question about it. A specialty clinic, really an ideal specialty clinic, would be a multi-specialty clinic. I mean, where you have your geriatrician and he has his ophthalmologist, ENT specialist, urologist, gynecologist, and if he needs beyond his own skills, a cardiologist or a respiratory person. I mean, these are all the people that the geriatrician is going to involve in a holistic approach to looking after a senior citizen. So I think this is very important. And I'm glad to see that many of our public hospitals have now started them. A few private hospitals are doing it. I think the private hospitals and the corporate hospitals can definitely step up their game. They can afford to have this. They can have, it should become a one-stop shop, you know. A geriatric, a senior citizen comes into the hospital, and he must be assured that he is going to given the same attention and the same detailed management, medical management, as you expect to receive for a baby, for a child. You know, it's the same way. And here I would also like to say one thing is that the hospitals have to also gear up to be able to deal with geriatric population. I mean, a very simple thing I'll tell you. If you have a geriatric ward, which is supposed to be mandatory in a hospital, and the approach corridor to that geriatric ward is not well lit, or does not have handrails, you know, on both sides, then we are not doing that service a justice. So we have to have ramps. I mean, you can't expect the senior citizen to, you know, struggle up those stairs. So there's so many little things that actually help and should be done. And specialty clinics, then geriatric care in hospitals. And I would say, in fact, the Supreme Court had given a mandate that the senior citizens should be given first priority. They were talking in terms of COVID treatment, but I think this priority should be there in all the sections, whether it's COVID, non-COVID, or whatever, and separate queues, separate personnel, people trained, like Nirmala has said. I mean, you know, hospitals should also employ people who can look after geriatric patients other than, you know, our own doctors and nurses. So I think it's very, very important. The time has come when no hospital can afford to say, I do not have a geriatric service in place. And I congratulate you all because you have started a geriatric home service. I think that's a wonderful thing because beyond the specialty clinic, the primary health center should also have a focus now on geriatrics. They have it on maternity and child. I think they should also have it on geriatrics because, you know, that whole issue of adult vaccination had come up. And I think they should be looking at this adult vaccination. And the other thing is, of course, ultimately, community care, which is unfortunately lacking in our country, is something that we need to promote. I'm glad this year the government, central government, has brought out nurse practitioners, you know, the whole course on nurse practitioners. So if we have nurse practitioners, then they can actually be our community healthcare providers. And I think that will go a long way in quality geriatric care.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Rekha, for your inputs. Now I'd like to ask Mr. Prakash about our senior citizens. We have spoken about digital literacy and what are various programs been conducted from various organizations. And you also mentioned what HelpAge India is already doing. But what our senior citizens need to be prepared for in the post-pandemic world? If you can share your opinion related to that, sir.
Okay, thank you. First of all, I must tell you one thing that HelpAge India is working more than 4 decades across India for the cause and care of elderly. No doubt our focus group is a disadvantaged older person and to improve their quality of life. But we want all elderly should live a dignified life. That is what we want. We run many programs. We are in healthcare. We are in financial inclusion. We are in livelihood. We are in social protection. So many things we are doing it. Even in this pandemic also, we have done a lot of work. Just for information for everybody, I must tell you that whenever any natural calamity is there, HelpAge India is known as a nodal agency. In all natural calamities or disaster, we are always there. We were there. Whether it is a earthquake or flood or tsunami, whatever you call, or even in this pandemic also. I remember last year when February 2020, suddenly some invisible virus, corona, just entered and it destroyed the life of everybody. And the situation has changed till today. So much of uncertainty, so many things were there. And right from day one, everybody was talking that elderly are vulnerable, do take care of them. Take care of your children and older people, that is very important. So everybody was bombarding that elderly are vulnerable. And what happened, you know, there was indirectly psychological pressure even on senior citizen. So many things we were talking, even today also we are talking, and everybody in this pandemic were talking about the social distancing. But what happened under the social distancing, I must tell you, because I've seen, I experienced this thing. I discussed with many senior citizens. They also expressed their concern. Under the name of this social distancing, they have been isolated and neglected. Many of the people, I do understand, because of the overprotection or the love, even the elderly, those who were staying with their family members, they were not able to come out from their room also. Forget coming down from the flat or their house. But even the family member used to tell them not to go even to the balcony also. Don't come out from your room. Overprotection, overlove, I understand. But because of that, what happened? There was a restricted mobility. The elderly, they were really had a lot of problems. Physical problem as well as then mental problem. And those who were staying alone, they were not being able to contact by anybody. We have so many such examples. Very big societies where 120, 150 people are staying, so many flats, but nobody has even time just to call or find out what is the requirement of these elderly couple who are staying alone in our society. Even they were not able to go down. I do understand. And they were calling to HelpAge India. We supported them. But what I'm telling you, these all, made a very psychological pressure on the mind of the senior citizen, and a lot of issues were there. Now, post-pandemic, still it is not over. We don't know. But still now we are telling, now this year, HelpAge India has told very clearly, build back better. We have to just have now the situation back better, and we have to build this such an environment where elderly should feel that they are safe, they require. We should lend that support to them. We should help them and just give them that, support that, okay, we are there with you. Even recently, you must have seen last week under the RTI, there was a report also that during this pandemic, there was so many suicidal cases. Amongst the elders as well as the youngsters also. Actually, today is not day to discuss about this thing. Today is the day to celebrate. We should talk about the graceful aging, everything, but these are the things are there. What I'm trying to tell you, are we giving such environment to our elderly? Not acceptable at all. We should create such an environment where elderly should feel that they are wanted. Somebody is there to help them and guide them and support them. That is very, very important. And towards that, HelpAge India always running such program and developing such new activities and the program where especially we involve senior citizens, even the younger generation also, because we want to restore that intergenerational bond. Most of the times we talk about the generation gap. I do agree. It is a generation gap because of the age factor. But moreover, it is a communication gap. We are not communicating. We are not talking. We are not sharing. So that is why it is very important to bring these generations together, back to bring back them together and to make them to understand. But at the same time, elderly also should note certain things that they should also change with the changing time. That is also very important. So many things also they should do it. And that is why we always help them, support them. And also we do the counseling even to the elderly also. That with the changing time, how they have to change. They have to manage their own. That is also very important. Because we should have the society or environment where everybody must have the environment or togetherness so that we can help each other. We are in healthcare, as I told you, we are running and many mobile healthcare units through which we are giving support. 170 such units are working. More than 35,000 free cataract operation we do it. In 22 places, we are having physiotherapy center. We have the livelihood group, especially in the rural area, where more than 25,000 elderly, they have been getting livelihood support through the elder self-help group. We have the helpline. We are conducting digital literacy program, many different activities. We have 4 old age homes, but more than 2,000 old age homes we are supporting. These all activities are going on, and it is only just to support elderly. And also we are involving elderly in our program. It is not just for them, but with them also we are doing it. That is very important. And that is how we all should come together and help our senior citizen, our elderly, to live a dignified life.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Borgaonkar. Now I will like to ask some of our participants.
So I think there is some problem with Mrudula's internet. So
am I audible now? Sorry for the internet issues. Now I like to ask some of our participants to share their experience with Jyeshtha Care. I like to invite Dr. Snehal Masurkar for her experience. She had received service, availed services from Jyeshtha Care.
Think she has left. She is not there.
Okay.
I think Manisha Singh is also availed our services for our mother, I think, Vijaya George. So you can ask Miss Manisha Singh.
Manisha Singh to the Vijaya George.
Yes.
Hello. I'm Manisha Singh's mother speaking, Vijaya George. Actually, I'm hearing your this program.
Okay.
Great. How are you doing?
Doing better, sir.
Great. So you can share your experience about how you felt about our services.
Very nice. I had physiotherapy also from your service. I was not able to walk with but now I can walk little. I had physiotherapy from your center.
It's very great to know.
With walker also, I was not able to walk, but I had this and I can walk now little.
Okay. This gives us more inspiration to provide better services to our elderly patient.
Definitely.
Thanks a lot for joining and contributing.
Thank you.
So I would think we can, just one last question we'll ask to each and every panelist. So we'll begin with Nirmala Madam. Like, what is the one advice you would give to Jyeshtha Care team like going forward?
It's very difficult for me to give you advice. You're doing wonderful thing. What we can see that how to make a happy life, livable life, for senior citizens, and we have to not address their issues emotionally, but we have to see that we create a good kind of a system upon which, you know, they can dwell upon it, and we should not make them so much dependent, and they don't require, we always say that they require emotional need, but take care of the emotional need, but take care of, the government should take care of the system which will, you know, help them with daycare centers, then their dementia special centers, then integrated services, then memory clubs, more elder care homes, and some kind of, you know, skill-based training, so, and some financial security, those who can get employed again, so provide them employment, etc. And then on-call services, provide them, make a sort of a system which they need not come out of the house, but all the system should reach to them, and basic diagnosis, etc., which can prevent their future degeneration or future problems.
Thank you, ma'am. Borgaonkar sir, if you can give an advice to our team.
No, advice. Dr. Thakur, I must tell you one thing. I met you some 4-5 years ago, I remember. Okay, we had a program, and I noticed that you wanted to do something. And I thought of you just talked, okay, and may not do something. But I'm very happy to see that you really were very serious that time, and you are also now serious, and you started the Jyeshtha Care service. That is very important. So first of all, I congratulate you on this, your Jyeshtha Care service, which you have started. You are doing fantastic work. I know. See, beginning, definitely there will be a lot of issues, a lot of problems, everything. We learn a lot from them. Okay. And on your first anniversary also, once again, congratulate to you and your team. Okay. And what I feel, okay, Jyeshtha Care should not be just limited to the only healthcare. When I say the healthcare, it is physical or mental. It should be beyond that. It has to be the holistic approach. Now you have to provide such services that these Jeshta also should be a part of your care services afterwards to give service to others. These are very important. Okay. See, and like Nirmala Samant has mentioned, that dependency should not be there. Okay. You are there to help them, support them, to guide them, to make them independent, not just dependent. Okay. So I hope that you can do it. You are doing fantastic work, and for your work, whatever the support you require from our side, we are always there. We'll be happy to collaborate with you. Okay. But see that it should be overall should be the holistic approach, because when I say the holistic, it is not just only health related, but it has to be the finance inclusion type, social protection issues. So many things has to be involved together into that. And this center should be termed as a gesture care, is one of the ideal centers across India, providing holistic services to the senior citizen for their better future.
Thanks a lot for your valuable advice.
Can I say something?
Yes.
Yeah. I also congratulate you for your first anniversary that you have successfully completed. So please accept my, what should I say? Can I give you?
No, ma'am, it is.
This bouquet.
Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Oh,
virtual bouquet.
Hi.
Thank you.
To you, you can accept. And what Prakash has said, that you are wonderful vision that you are providing the gesture care services. My advice to all the senior citizens that they should take gesture care services from you, and you should also, you know, see to it that the government and the NGOs and the society should have gesture care type of services more and more. That is a need of the most. Such services should be there, when I was saying that they require everything at a doorstep, means at least online, sometimes offline, and advice, special needs, as Dr. Rekha Bhatkhande said, that special needs are there, and we don't have that much services which can cater to senior citizens. So there is a need of the hour, we have gesture care special services to them.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Rekha, if you have any advice for us.
So a very simple advice to the entire gesture care team is just try and make the lives of senior citizens easier. The minute you make their lives easier, they are going to be happy. They are going to be able to do their activities of daily living with a lot more zest. And all these, the mental hygiene will improve. There's so much thing, there's so much. But Srinivas, I'll take this platform to bring up two issues which I feel your services can address. One is, we're always very worried about senior citizens falling. Okay? So this, with osteoporosis and sarcopenia, I mean, if you were to address both these issues, but also if your counselors could actually make it very, give practical advice of how to keep your home, trip and slip free, where you come out of the bathroom and you should have non-skid mats there, and you should have grab rails, and there's so many small little things which I think your services can advise and make your life just that much easier. The second issue that I feel that we should all be addressing is the issue of polypharmacy. The more comorbid diseases that senior citizens have, the bigger the pill burden, the bigger the burden of medicines that they have, that they have to take every day. And this is something I feel that, if your team could counsel them, could teach them, could give them some sort of, a very clear advice of how they should be taking their medicines, when to take them, how to see that they don't miss out you know. And I mean, these are things that can be taught, and it will only help the senior citizens, and maybe or could even connect with their own consultants as to whether you could actually bring about a lessening of that, you know, med burden, you know, because sometimes it's quite often that you don't really need all the medicine that are prescribed. So I think that would be a wonderful thing if you could go into that detail. That's my advice to Jeshtha Care team. They're doing an excellent job. Please continue your home care services, because I think that's a very, very important part of our lives today. And all the very best.
Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Kapoor, if you don't continue, I have to just attend one more program now.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks a lot, sir, for coming.
No. Thank you very much. Once again, hearty congratulations to all of you. And thank you, all the respected guests. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
We have 2 minutes. I'll just like to, can I answer her inputs, Dr. Srinivas?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so Dr. Rekha, I'm very glad to share with you that we have had one entire webinar on house proofing for elderlies. I think Dr. Srinivas can share the link with all of us. It's available there live on YouTube and on Facebook. But you know, that part, we are definitely thinking of that. And whenever our patients or people who are receiving services from us do ask input, Dr. Srinivas is always guiding them on that part. And as also Nirmala ma'am said, that multi-speciality and multiple services, we'll just take a minute to explain what all services we are already providing, and then Dr. Srinivas can conclude for the day. So some of our services include home doctor visits, which she has already mentioned, nursing care by certified nurses, trained attendees to assist the elders in their daily activities, home physiotherapy sessions by our team of expert physiotherapists, geriatric assessment and counseling by our experienced psychologist, nutrition advice by dietitian, selling and renting of medical equipments like hospital beds, oxygen concentrators, etc., and lab tests, everything at the comfort of their own homes. So this is a small bundle right now we are offering. I'm sure Dr. Srinivas will keep adding more and more flowers to the bouquet. Now over to you, Dr. Srinivas.
I think Mrs. Seema Joshi wants to tell something, share something.
Yes. Namaskar. आज ज्येष्ठ केअर फाउंडेशनचा पहिला वर्धापन दिन आहे आणि मी सीमा जोशी, माझ्या सासरे जे ही वॉज 93 इयर्स ओल्ड आणि माझ्या सासूबाई या दोघांनाही ज्येष्ठ केअर तर्फे मेडिकल सपोर्ट आणि केअरिंग मुख्य म्हणजे हे अतिशय उत्तम प्रकारे मिळालेलं आहे. त्याचप्रमाणे इतरांना सुद्धा या पॅन्डेमिक काळामध्ये, विशेषतः सगळ्या सिनियर सिटीजन्सना, परिस्थितीचा स्वीकार कसा करावा आणि आनंदाने कसं जगावं, आपले शारीरिक स्वास्थ्य कसे जपावे याचे उत्तम मार्गदर्शन या व्हर्च्युअल माध्यमातून वेळोवेळी ज्येष्ठ केअरच्या सगळ्या डॉक्टरच्या टीमने दिलेलं आहे. विशेषतः डॉक्टर श्रीनिवास आणि डॉक्टर मृदुला यांनी अनेक तज्ज्ञ मार्गदर्शकांच्या तर्फे आणि अर्थातच गेस्ट तर्फे विविध विषयांवरती अनेक सेशन्स आणि इंटरॅक्शन आपण आत्ताच मगाशी बघितलं, त्याने डिटेल्स दिलेले आहेत. ते सगळे हे जग बोधे निववावे या तीनुसार अतिशय स्पेशलाइज्ड अशा प्रकारचं मार्गदर्शन मिळालेलं आहे आणि त्याबद्दल मी अतिशय कृतज्ञ आहे या ज्येष्ठ केअर फाउंडेशनची. त्यांच्या स्वप्नांच्या ध्येयवेड्या प्रवासासाठी माझ्याकडून खूप खूप शुभेच्छा. आणि या सगळ्या ज्येष्ठांच्या मनामध्ये जी भावना आहे ती मी एका छोट्याशा कवितेने व्यक्त करू इच्छिते. ऊर्जा स्त्रोत कसे होतसे वादळ, तसे होतसे वादळ शहाणे, चला घेऊया त्याचा बोध, भान दिशेचे जाण स्वतःची, लपला त्याचा सुंदर बोध, झपाटले पण हवे हवेसे, नवता संयम अपरंपार, जग डोक्यातील अवचित उतरे, कधी निराशा कधी अंगार, ध्येय दीप शोधता शोधता, झालो होतो अति बेजार ज्योत पेटल्या विना कसा तो गायब होई घन अंधार चिंतनातुनी भान मनाचे नीट कळावी मूर्तीकार क्षमता सोबत सहजपणे मग कमतरतांची होई स्वीकार तन्मयता ही क्षणाक्षणाला गुणवत्तेची अविरत साथ मुक्का माचे विरता ओझे स्वधर्म सूर्याचा अवतार त्यात उरातील देत रहावे उरला मग हाच विचार शहाणे वादळ नाहीच वादळ तो तर झाला ऊर्जा स्त्रोत मन फुलवतो प्रेरक होतो अंतरातील मग प्रकाश झोत अंतरातील मग प्रकाश झोत धन्यवाद
वाह वाह
थैंक्स अ लॉट खूप छान बोलले आपण आणि just last few slides I'll be presenting and after that we'll be wrapping up.
Can I just say and congratulate you all? Thank you much. Yeah, thank you so much. I think you have been doing wonderful work. But as Dr. Rekha said, I think the holistic approach would be the wonderful thing. And just now that music app, Dr. Shenoy, you know, you have launched and all. Similarly, even other activities, if you could just pursue and online, some workshops and all could be arranged, then that will be making them more independent also, as the other aspect of Jyeshtha Nagarik of finances and this and that and all. That's what I was wondering. I just did recently a course on holistic medicine. I am a pediatrician basically, and I did it, and we have a senior citizens association here, and we do carry out so many activities. So I think you have been also doing wonderful work. I just wanted to share that, and our diseases and the way in which the senior citizens are living, if one can collaborate these two things and explore the possibility of their problems, that would be the ideal thing to do, which will be more helpful. That's what I felt. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, ma'am, for your suggestion. We'll definitely do that also.
Yeah, please. Thank you.
So just to summarize, Jyeshtha Care is basically an initiative which is led by a specialist elderly care specialist doctor. Our focus is mainly on the assistance of make sure that the elderly are independent to as much extent as possible. We provide nursing as well as trained attendants. There is a regular monitoring by our team, and all the staff that we provide are thoroughly background verified. And especially for this month of October and being our first anniversary, we have decided that whatever services we are providing, there is going to be a flat 10% discount on all and any of the services, which is valid for the entire month of October. So if any of your patients or relatives or anybody requires it, then please, they can contact our team at the customer support number, and we'll be glad to help them in any way that is possible. And with this, I would like to conclude the session, and I would like to thank Nirmala ma'am, Dr. Rekha ma'am, and the other people who had joined us, and also to all the participants who have come for making this event successful. And next year, we would try to be more innovative and do some other activities for this session also, rather than just keep it as a talk session. And thank you once again for everyone for coming for our event.
Huge congratulations to you as well, Dr. Srinivas. It's really a good initiative you have taken, and I'm sure being a part of the team, all the activities which you provide, how easier, how convenient it makes for the service receivers, which usually come and visit our clinics. So huge congratulations to you as well. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.